The nation was shocked and stunned when on December the 7th, 1941, Pearl Harbor was bombed. And President Roosevelt calmed the nation on radio. "The only thing we have to fear is fear itself." Pope John Paul II is speaking to young people growing up with all the upheaval and changes in society. Soothe them. Do not be afraid. You are not alone. And those first disciples huddled together behind locked doors for fear of those who had killed their friend, their leader. They had crucified Jesus, so what would they do to them? "Peace be with you," the risen Lord affirmed. He appeared before them miraculously. "Peace be with you," another passage says. "Not as the world gives, do I give peace to you." His peace, if primarily the forgiveness of sin, all sin, another gift was a vision he had of life, filled with the presence of God, and a way of living out that vision, a way of compassion, of constant prayer to his Father, a way of rejoicing in life and of accepting the inevitable pain of being human. And so, when he appeared to them, he showed them his hand and his sides. So does the Lord greet us this morning. "Peace be with you." You know, we're all different stages in our gathering today. Health, wealth, relationships, the basic stance we have with life. Some, for example, for whatever reason, are anxious about life. They fear tomorrow. And others are sort of stoic. What is, it's going to all pass. But Jesus has a different kind of a tone. He says to all of us, no matter where we are, "My peace I give you. I am with you and for you. As I have overcome, rooted in accepting my Father's love, so do I offer this kind of peace to you. Know that you are loved by the Father." Note that they were together. Instinctively, in their fear and loneliness and grief, they gathered together like mourners at a wake or members of a support group in a tragedy, or we, who share a common vision of the coming of the reign of God, knowing every moment is important. And we need one another to encourage one another to continue our search and to live out our convictions. So do we turn to one another in our Eucharistic assembly and we say to one another, "Peace be with you, the peace of Christ be with you." We're all joined to each other. In a sense, we belong to each other, but first of all, we belong to Christ. In reflecting how he did, what he did, who he was, this connects with the deepest understanding of what we have to be fully human. He is not a person who is sort of abstracted from the realities of life. No, he connects with us at every stage of where we are and who we are. It is the God-centeredness of Jesus that draws me. If someone should say to me, "What really connects you with this Jesus?" I would say, well, first of all, he's God-centered. His Father is the center of his life. He knows the Father is the source of his life, of the stars in the sky and the birds in the air and the lilies in the field. But most of all, Jesus is so very aware that God is in each one of his brothers and sisters and friends, no matter who they are, no matter where they are. And he's especially with the most in need. And when we understand and act in this spirit, then we are embraced by the peace that he offers. He turned to his apostles and he said to them, "As the Father has sent me, so I send you." By consciously understanding life as mission, so do we strengthen and deepen the bonds of union with Jesus. You know, when I was in the Air Force, the thing that struck me most of all was how prepared The airmen were, for their mission, they were air commandos. They were about to go to Vietnam. And they marched and they drilled and they heard endless talks by officers about what it takes to be a faithful airman. Courage and loyalty to one another and to the nation. You know, I point out that husbands and wives and children, really all of us, disciples of Jesus, should consciously be in mission. The Father calls us through Jesus to be God-centered in our life, to have a profound sense of its meaning. And Jesus calls his friends to continue this mission, giving ourselves generously and perseveringly, in little ways and in big ways, in families, no matter where we are. The Easter message of new life calls us to examine our life responses, using our mind and our imagination to find ways of evidencing not only that Jesus lives, but that Jesus lives in us. And then there are the ministries to which we are called, where we work, being part of the faith community. In these many ministries, we rub shoulders with one another. We encourage one another to continue and deepen the journey of faith. We have a profound sense of our identity. Just before Mass started, I talked with a man who was part of our group from the very beginning. And he said, you know, this is my home. He's involved in many ministries of the church. This is my home. This is where I belong. This is where somehow I have a sense of who I am. So we are called to deepen our sense of faith. The people who serve in music ministry, do you realize what it takes to do that? Week after week, practicing, being with one another, making our liturgy such a beautiful expression of faith. Think about it. Those people who serve mind, circle, who's sharing word and sacrament, in visiting the sick and the elderly, the people who week after week serve in the food pantry, gathering together all the stuff that needs to be gathered, putting in packages, and then giving them to the needy on Thursday. There are so many ways of serving God in faith, and young people who minister serve it by being altar servers. I could go on and on about the work that is done by people, but you know, you never get that sense of belonging, of really being part of the community, unless you give not just money, but unless you give your time and your talent to somehow have the faith community become ever more than it was before you joined. Because that's really the purpose of it all, to serve the human family so that they will be joined to Christ. And Christ joins them to the Father. But in each of them, in each of the ministries, we experience the joy of serving, of being together, of connecting with this Jesus who invites us. And so today we hear the ringing words of the risen Lord, "Peace be with you. I send you with the power of the Spirit to bring peace, unity, forgiveness, joy, in ways that you can, in ways that others can receive." And then we reach out to a wider world, so that whenever believers care for one another, support a grief family, pressure political leaders to provide a place for refugees, protest racism and anti-Semitism, when believers lead the way calling for more funding for disadvantaged children, whether they're in the ghetto, or in Schoenhoffen Estates or Schomburg, then there is the evidence that believers see the wounds on the risen Christ. The body of Christ, the church, the human family, with all its needs. So we proclaim, Christ is risen. Christ is truly risen. Alleluia. And may the same Christ be alive in us as we journey towards the Father, ground in faith.